this in. Go ahead. Okay, go ahead and repeat.
What I was saying is that sometimes I've heard stories of teenagers who've been kicked out by their families for having a pregnancy that initially wasn't theirs. And to be honest, it's pretty unfair.
What do you mean a pregnancy that wasn't theirs? Oh, you mean it's not their fault?
Yes, not their
fault. Okay, okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Sometimes it can just be a little disheartening to see how mothers who have undergone the same experience would do something to their children. Like, let's assume that the parents have gone through that, but they don't understand, like, the pain of the teenage child doing that. Sometimes they come child-rearing, and it isn't really their fault. Like, they've been forced to be
become
a parent. It's not really, sometimes... Sorry.
So how difficult is that the experience has been for these 3 days? Mentally, how does it affect you physically? What do you think about parenting? Whether it's by choice or, you know.
Okay, if I am to be completely honest, as soon as I heard that baby cry, I flinched.
Mm-hmm.
But the first day, I was admittedly just shivering. And I was hyperventilating because I wasn't sure how I was going to manage this task. And sometimes I forgot that I have my own family to help me from time to time.
But in this case, you're expected to do it all by yourself.
Yeah.
So what was it like getting up? How often did you have to get up throughout the night?
For the first night, I only had to get up once. The second time, maybe like...
Once? At what time?
Around 2 a.m., maybe 3 a.m.
For what? Feeding?
Usually for feeding, because the baby would sleep for about 8 hours or so on and so forth. Something like that.
I don't think it was 8 hours after 2 a.m.
No, before 2 a.m., it would be about 8 hours. And then we would wake up.
You're going to have to check your stats on that.
Probably.
Your numbers, because I think you're a little off. Yeah. But what did it do to you mentally? Or can you imagine a child your age having a baby?
That's a terrifying thought. Because initially the thought of childbirth and its surgery costs, all that procedure, it's scary. And then the initial shock of having a child, it doesn't really go away. Because even if you're assured that you'll be getting help from loved ones and such, like, I had hallucinations of babies crying and I couldn't really get good sleep. So that's why I was just up, always very jittery whenever it came to this baby.
And every time the child makes a sound, you get very overwhelmed.
Yeah. Sometimes it could be just cooing, or maybe it could just be just small sounds just to show that the baby's awake. Couldn't necessarily be quiet crying. Hold on, I'm just gonna do this cycle real quick.
Okay. So, how do you differentiate the cries?
It's really a guessing game from time to time, but sometimes it's hard to really tell. It's hard to really explain to any like first time parents or whatnot. But really what I try to do before anything is feed the baby, because sometimes it may have slept for a while and needs to be fed. Or the next best thing, rock it, because it could just need attention, something like that. But sometimes there's like an inch to differentiating their cries, and that's the, like, I like to call it a prerequisite cry.
Mm-hmm.
That determines what the type of need the baby wants. So like for feeding now, it made like a small breathy, I want to say, noise. Mm-hmm. And so I like coughing maybe a little. That sound too, that means it needs to be fed.
And what about the changing of diapers? How?
They will make like an audible like coughing cry noise. And it's hard to really explain to people who are not parents or have not experienced child rearing before, so I can't really give an accurate response. This is just a robotic imitation of what a real baby would be like.
But it's very close.
Very close.
In terms of the cluster feeds.
Speaking of, it's done feeding. It's 6:46, like I predicted. I predicted it'd be about 15 minutes this time around.
So after 3 days, you sort of have a clear understanding of the patterns for feeding.
Yeah. Especially now, it's likely that this baby, it hasn't cluster fed very much. It has a low chance of needing to be burped, but it might have a chance of needing to be changed.
So for the next time.
Yeah. So I'm going to, if it needs to be burped, it'll do so within the first 2 minutes. And if it's not that, it'll usually need to be changed, in which I have the diaper at the ready.
Mm-hmm.
I think they've really, toned down the intensity of what to do for the baby these years, maybe. Something like that. Because now, as my mom has mentioned when she was talking to me about what it was like for my older sibling now, she said that back then, they didn't need to use these sort of sensors to really... Oh. So, pause.
Okay, now that you've had this experience taking care of this baby for the last 3 days, what is your feelings about motherhood? And in terms of you becoming a mother one day, what would be your plan or your perspective on becoming a mother?
That's a good question. And while of course I can't give a straight answer, since although this simulation is pretty close to what being a parent, especially in your teens, would be like, I can't give a proper a full direct answer. But based on the simulation, it's good that especially schools these days are allowing teenagers, high schoolers, to experience the throes of parenthood, which include having to stay up at staying up at late hours in the night. That's only part of it. Sometimes there's the mental anguish, is what I want to say, mental anguish that comes with having to get up at this hour, having to follow a schedule day after day after day. And it's for this day, for the simulation, I only got it for 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
Take that. But having to do it for the rest of your life. Not even just until they turn 18. For the rest of your life. Because you can't really send your child, especially here in Canada, out in the world. Especially since, there's so many problems with, a housing crisis, rising costs of living. So that's why it's more likely you will see families still together with their children after they turned 18. Maybe they'll be in their 30s.
That's true.
They'll still be there.
Very good point.
Mm. But overall, for the question on how I feel about motherhood,
mm-hmm.
I think this simulation is a good, sometimes you may call it an effective method of birth control or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it gives a good perspective on what it is like to be a parent. And while no hate to people who have been taken advantage of in their youth, no hate to that, but it's a good idea that they at least understand what it's like to be a parent for the very first time, especially if you don't have any other external sources of support that isn't your immediate family. Because there are periods where parents would, like I mentioned before, kick out their children or something like that for having a children that they didn't initially intend to have at the time.
Right.
So really, in the end, first of all, it's really good to have an immediate source of support, from your family, siblings who've experienced with younger siblings, their younger siblings before. So those like that. But
so how useful was the emotional support that you got? Because we couldn't help you with this baby, but emotionally we were there. You just wanted to know that I was in the room. You didn't really want me to go anywhere without you. Yeah. I had to postpone whatever I had to do just for the emotional support?
The first day, I was petrified because for a period of time, you weren't immediately available for me to, like, be there with me while I take care of the baby.
Mm-hmm.
But I was petrified because I didn't know what to do for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
So I turned to my older sister for help just to stay there with me while I tried to not go insane with this baby.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. So the emotional support was very important in this case.
Yeah, but it doesn't just have to be emotional support from your family. And honestly, in this moment, I truly believe that if you are planning on having, like, a child, or you're planning on child rearing,
mm-hmm.
it's important or almost crucial
mm-hmm.
to at least have a loving partner who'd be dedicated to taking care of the child with you. Because really, all of this is so much for a single mom or a single father. Even both of them, it can be very hard for both parties, let alone in a single mother or a single father.
So what do you have to say to the single mothers and fathers who are actually doing it?
I envy you so much.
Envy?
I am so jealous of you very much.
For what?
Because you, the fact that you are able to meet the child's needs day after day, and I wouldn't blame you if you somehow felt a little bit of resentment, because that is common in some parents
mm-hmm.
to feel resentment or depression. That's postpartum depression
mm-hmm.
in some families. But overall, I feel both jealousy because they managed to do that for so many years of
their life. You're jealous of their strength, their mental
yes.
strength?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I, after these 3 days and seeing how I am not a fully fledged mother mm-hmm. as of yet,
mm-hmm.
and I probably won't be for a very long time.
You're traumatized.
Yeah. No, I am very much traumatized after these 3 days.
Okay. Well, I'm going to say you did a fantastic job. You surprised me. You were so attentive to this baby. You showed that maternal side of you. And you wanted to make sure the baby was fine. You just did really, really, really well.
At the expense of everyone else's sanity. I have my sister here who I was begging her to at least be there for me. And she would not stay in the same room.
Because
and I was panicking.
When it was her turn, she wasn't able to do it. She cried a lot. So, you know, see, not everyone has the strength to deal with this, because it's a lot. It's a lot for me and I'm a mom. Okay? All right. Thanks for the interview.